future challenges or challenges that we just started to undertake. Example of challenges are Apple Siri and Google Now. But perhaps one of the best stories 2 years ago was that of IBM Watson, the machine that beat the experts, the people who were Jeopardy winners. So for a machine to have beat human in a task which is not trivial is very significant. Earlier example was that of chess, Big Blue, and beating the human chess players. So what is very exciting is that one of the core members of the team for IBM Watson, Chris Welty, will be a speaker here, distinguished speaker, on the 10th of April. So it's about noon, and you guys all are invited, in fact, more or less expected. You learn quite a great deal. And for those of you who are further interested, after having dealt with the Jeopardy challenge, IBM currently is focusing on healthcare delivery. And they want to make Watson as a assistant to doctors. It so happens that the claim is that Watson actually can more accurately diagnose diseases than an average doctor. There will always be cases so complicated the machine won't succeed, but there will be in large number of cases machine might do on the average better than human. Of course, because of regulatory concern, because we hate to believe that machine can be better than human, we're not going to replace doctor by Watson. But you can imagine that in future Watson will be available to any consumer putting in stuff and at least get a sense of what doctor would think. Right? And even if it cannot prescribe the medication, it will say this might be the medication, so go and talk to your doctor. So Chris, for example, is currently working with Cleveland Clinic, WellPoint, and Major. I just saw, half an hour ago, a message here saying that tomorrow IBM and all these major healthcare companies are making a major announcement about what they are going to do in healthcare. And Chris will be also discussing with us, especially on a round table, perhaps in this room, what they are doing there, and then students who are in that area and otherwise can ask questions and really understand. So again, we have exceptional world-class learning available that will continue from today's class. But now I'll pass on to Sarasi.
Discussing about some factors or some major advancement that we would love to see when we go to the semantic search area. So we started discussing some of these, and I'll discuss some more. So we discussed about the concept and entity search and providing related relevant results with the entity that we are searching for, and question answering search, of course, the thing came with IBM Watson, and the generalized and specialized queries. And then we are starting the things that we plan to talk today, the current trend or the temporal aspects of a query. So for example, if we want to know who is the new president, so if just after a presidential election, search engine should be able to figure out, okay, now the president is changed, this is the new president. And the location of the search, when we say what is the temperature, I think for this type of query, even the location and the temporal aspect, the both would matter. So what is the temperature, I mean today, and the place that I mean to give the temperature. I think these kind of things, even facilitated by the Google search engine as of now. And then the personalization aspect would come. For example, if I search a chicken recipe on Google, for example, I would mostly get the baked chicken and kind of thing. But my personal preference will always to be a spicy mix chicken recipe. So my search engine would be intelligent to figure it out that what my taste is and give the personal preferences for me as well. So that's why what we mean by the personalization. And then we come to the contextual interpretation. Since we had a lot of discussion on the class for the context, I would like to get some ideas from you. What is really the contextual interpretation of the semantic search when it comes to here? So of course, the temporal aspect, the location, and the personalization aspect would be there in the context. What else that we can have when we have the query in that way? What do you think? So we have the maybe the location we are in, the time we are in, and our personalization preferences. So is that what we meant by the context, or is there anything else that we need to consider? Any comments?
The text surrounding it, like in which context you are talking the entity about.
Let's say we pose a search query to the search engine, so we talk in that sense. I know that you are talking about when we are processing the text, considering the relevant other text appearing in the text. But let's consider we are posing some query into the search engine, then the context that we are looking for.
The past searches that I've made.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Related to that.
Yeah.
So if I'm more interested in sports and if I enter cricket, then I would expect the sport to appear because I have a history of searching for sports always and not cricket, the service provider.
But even that we can consider as the personalization aspect, right?
I guess.
Yeah.
Is that really an aspect though? I mean, like, so what people are afraid of, like, oh, they're gathering data on what I search for. So then, like, if you want to take that context out, does that break the entire flow of there? Like, how would you know then? If you took out, like, previous searches, how would you know what personalization would be? You wouldn't be able to track everybody's. If you took everybody's personalization out, you wouldn't have a way to know what people previously searched for.
It depends, right?
I mean, like, how? So give me an example of how you would know how somebody searched something if you didn't track what they were searching for previously.
The previous search records?
Yeah, like, what if you don't know how to keep those? What if for some reason you can't keep search?
Well, like on Amazon.com, right? You know, if you bought stuff from there, you get
their
front page looks different than if you go like with that with cookies disabled or whatever. You just get like a plain, like these are the most popular things people are buying, but it's not tailored to you.
Yeah.
So
like,
I mean, you'd have to have some. I mean, you always have to have some like default something.
Yeah. If you really don't know about the person, you cannot make personalized preferences.
Yeah.
But that's
no
worse than what we have now.
Yeah.
So it's no better, but it's no worse.
You think they'd move to more like a regional thing, like where most people in your region searching for, they couldn't pinpoint like exact. I mean, because that's like, if you take out the personalization part, then you just have basically a blind kind of, this is the newest stuff. How would that affect the semantic web approach?
Actually, one thing which also I'm found might be this is related with this. Like, if you have open Gmail, right? And if you're trying to search anything in Google, so suppose in one network you are there, if you go in different network with a different computer, so when you open your Gmail and you start your search in Google, you will find that whatever you type in, you will get the same thing in your in Google search part also, like whatever you're searching previously. So might be that Google Gmail also search your keyword, store your keywords. Whatever you have
said. Some kind of
which I found this like they are creating a user model kind of thing while searching. Even this is the way we are like to know what the people are doing.
So I mean recently there is a lot of work in integrating the social data into the search aspect as well. So we'll discuss them in the later how the main sentence.
So the location is an example of context for that matter, right? And but basically, context is a catch-all word, and you can have anything. One extreme form of context would be that there is an idea called life log, and a project called life log. So that would record the entire life history. So, for example, Microsoft made a little gadget, the camera, that takes snaps, and you just wear it all day, and it every minute or every 5 minutes it takes a snap, and it is taking, you know, it records the location and where it, so basically, where are you? So it will have taken a snap of this, you know, my presence in this room, and you know, probably knows that I'm in this room, and you carry this for year over year, and you know, huge history of your life is built up. Right? That is an extreme. So just like Amazon buying is a, you know, they have a log of all the things you purchase. They may have a log of all the things you have in your wish list. They have a log of all the things that you have selected, you know, in the, you know, and read the review of. So people, you know, that is part of the context. And now some of the Apple or somebody has filed a patent for it to record when you are actually using any of their tools. It will turn on the camera, and it will notice which part of the page you are watching, as an example. And that same thing is coming to the TV also, where TV would have a camera built in and is watching what you are, when are you paying attention to what is being shown, and what part of the picture you might be paying attention to, left corner, right corner, and they would have additional knowledge annotations inside saying, oh, it was this particular actor here. And this is the one getting the notation, not this particular part, you know, attention, not this part. So I think there's an unlimited form of context that is possible about the person, about the location, about the history, and so on and so forth, right? In the Google now, already you would use your daily pattern. So when you, for example, ask for a direction, it actually has a knowledge that indeed you be now traveling. Generally at 5:30 you'll be, or 6 o'clock you'll be leaving office to go at home. And it may interpret travel related query you may have in that context. Right? So this is, you know, the amount of background that people are building, the context that people are building is just vast. And this is combined by the fact that every click you are making is being logged by somebody on the web. And it is going to some database that is licensed for everybody else to use.
Even it can be possible, like whatever the email we get, right? So like Google search or even email provider, whoever. So they can understand what kind of email you get, and they can provide they create a model also, like it can be possible like this way also, right? So because whatever advertisement we get in a Gmail, right? So it's all related with the content which I have in my inbox.
One interesting thing though, the shift that is happening, is that until now all those quote unquote models, if I used to use that word generically, were all statistical models. The frequency of the use of words, and they were string or keyword level. What is changing now is that the systems are increasingly building some sort of domain models or some sort of knowledge, like Google knowledge base graph is one example. But people are building that. Now, here's an interesting thing. Siri, you know, the Apple Siri search, right? Siri was started by Tom Gruber. And one of the last employee was Martin, David Martin. Not too long ago, I had, you know, we were at the conference and we went and saw Beethoven's birthhouse, you know, in where the conference was in Germany. So, that guy was an ontologist, domain model builder. So even though it's not hardcore formal ontologists that they use, but indeed the people who kind of are key players in the Siri that Apple bought for about $200 million, I believe, was were semantic web people. So he played a very important role in building this, in building Siri. In fact, Siri, Watson, and those other things, these are the ones that really show the world the semantic web is for real. Until then, people were not sure that this will scale or it's real, you know, it's just AI things that can fail. But after that, it was. So anyway.
So then, one other form of to some domain, maybe foodborne based bowl, or this is a food recipe or something like that. And at the same time, maybe once we have a document, then spotting entities and giving more information about the entities can be another form of semantically annotating results. So these are the this set that I'm giving, it's something that I found online, so you guys are anywhere welcome if you want to add something into it. And then come to the faceted search, that we search based on the metadata. That means the search engine would provide like certain attributes that we can enter when we are searching the data, and then based on that it will give us the results. And then of course semantic web search. So as you know, in the current web we have web of documents, but our concept in semantic web is to have web of data. So we publish data sets in RDF format, and then by having the interlinks between each and every data set. For example, if you are familiar with the linked open data concept, so we have a linked open data cloud that when we have our RDF data set, we can go and publish our data set in the LOD, and at the same time we have other data sets, so we are always making the links from our data set to other data set. For example, if we as Noises going to publish a data set in Noises in LOD, so we have the entity called Amit Sheth, and if Amit Sheth will appear in the DBpedia, we'll say okay, these two are same entities, the same URI, so the same people. So if somebody was finding information in DBpedia about Amit, then they will be coming into the Noises link and they will find more information. Probably the person will get to know what are the PhD student who is working with them. So something like that. So it's an interconnected guy and graph that we can find the information. So searching on those kind of data sets, it's a different aspect which has very different challenges. But it will be important to incorporate that kind of a search into our normal search as well. So we'll discuss some of the system which try to address in the intro. And then, even though not very special, but searching with synonyms, of course, we have seen it. And also refining the search query. For example, if I type palm on the search, asking, OK, do you mean palm tree or palm device or something like that. And then variation of the terms, identifying that dog and dogs, what the difference between the singular and the plural. So that would be another matter. And also, of course, the different meaning comes when we have different grouping of the words. For example, for these two queries that we have, having the product and the benefit at the end would change the result entirely. So it's important to identify what is the most important part of your query.
Newegg is inline, online vendor also?
Yes. So those are the things that I found interesting in the trend that we are going right now. If you have something else that we didn't discuss, you are welcome to point them out. So anything else that you feel important to be there in the semantic search that we didn't discuss maybe? Okay, so then we discussed what we expect by semantic web. And now let's talk about how we are going to realize. So when we say semantic search, is it search with the semantic web? If you have seen the presentation, you know the answer, but if not, can we realize all the things that we mentioned as semantic search by only using semantic web techniques? Yes, no. So definitely we'll need to use the statistical techniques, natural language processing, and machine learning. They always play a very critical role in semantic search. And also, when it comes to semantics, it can be very informal. It should not be a properly defined model. So if you look at Dr. Sheth's paper about implicit and formal and powerful paper, and they discuss about some informal semantics. Okay, so this change in the search history, we can identify it in this way. So initially we started with keywords. Basically we only had strings, and search engine identified everything using the strings we had. And then we got the concept like entity concept, or the Google, the thing Google mentioning as things. And at the same time, then we are moving into the entities with relationships. So, okay, we have two entities. Now we should the search engines should have a better understanding how these two entities are connected with each other. So when it comes to relationship, as you know, because we have discussed already in the class, we have hierarchical relationships and we have the relationship between the domains that we call domain relationships. And also certain constraints that we want to pose in our model. So these things will change the search as it is now. So then we are going to talk about some search engines, semantic search engines that we had. But the first two systems that we are talking about are very early adopters of semantic search when we didn't talk much about the semantic search. So the first thing that we are going to talk about, Dr. Shedd's early systems that he came up with when he was working with companies. So I think it first started with Thali and then the company is acquired by another company called Vortec, right?
Vortec.
And then
it was merged and acquired by Synax.
But I think the underlying application is almost the same with
the
additional functionalities, kind of.
Yeah, the search part was built by Thali, and it's describing that pattern already.
Okay. So so now we are going to describe some features or how the system is being built. So the search engine consists of mainly three components. The first one is the extractor agents that would go into the unstructured and structured data and then collect the metadata. And then the word model, which is like a definition of the hierarchies and the models.
It's the same as ontology today.
Same as the ontology today. And the metabase to store the metadata collected over there. So if I got it correctly, the search engine will not index all the pages as it is. It would index only the metadata that they extracted from the pages. So because of that, system had the capability to load the system in a main memory, which has the fast responses, I guess.
That didn't matter, actually.
Okay.
So search, you know, it's an index and then you search.
But see, all the things that you were trying to do, if we were going to index all the pages, I don't think when it comes to scalability, it will work, right? When it comes to metadata...
Not really. Google indexes all the things, so it does scale and not everything, you know. But
Google are not doing anything like any metadata extraction like this search engine did.
They did not do it. I think now they do a little bit of it. Like, for example, if you have Google Knowledge Graph, then obviously they are spotting the entity. So clearly, now if the entity is described in this Google Knowledge Graph or is a form of knowledge-based ontology, then obviously that is a metadata because now there is a description of that, right? You know what it is about. Now you know it's a name of a location, right? So so in a form, it is becoming semantic and hence, you know, and it is being treated as metadata. So that is also happening.
Okay.
But not for earlier years, no. That was not the case. Earlier, it was indexing of the words that occurred there.
Okay, so these three are the major components that we can identify. So these are some features that they some mechanism that they use. So they try to automatically classify the documents, and then they extract the metadata from the documents, and they do the semantic normalization. Yes.
On the previous page, you said they don't actually index each page, they just index the information on it, like metadata of it. Would that mean that if you like made a search for something specific, say like Dr. Chef, it would give you like almost like a custom page that would be like where it found all the pieces and put it to one spot?
The page will be stored, but the indexing will not be based on the words in the document.
The question is whether do you do full text indexing of all the words, the text you come across, or you extract from the text metadata, and obviously that you should index and so that you can do fast search on that. So that is a question. And the issue is that actually we did do full text indexing also. But what we did is our search was stratified. So we would give higher priority for terms that would match with the as a metadata, because that is recognized as more meaningful terms that we already understood with regards to our ontology.
And when we don't find the terms that are already semantically notated or that are, you know, accepted, then we will, our default will be the keyword search that anybody else had. So for the, if you don't do that, then our recall will be very bad. So for the sake of recall, so that you'll find the same thing that a non-semantic search engine in our days, we had Excite, Lycos, AltaVista. We wanted to be able to do the same thing they did, but we wanted to do the semantic part also. If you don't not do this normal search, then customers would have a problem with that, saying, hey, you can't find many documents, you can find a few documents and that recall is not good enough and so it's not a good search. So we actually had to do that.
Okay, so when it comes to semantic normalization, it tries to identify whether the two documents described about the same thing and the different names are used to describe the same concept. And semantic search, of course, and semantic association, how two entities will be related in the document. So this is the architecture of the system. So we have an ontology that we called the world model. And there'll be some knowledge agents who would go into trusted knowledge sources and extract the knowledge and populate the ontology. So I'm always curious about the world model that you had. So you said that you only used two people to work in the ontology. So if you can tell us more details about what kind of domains you had in the system, like what kind of customers you had, because the ontology, the world model will be different based on their requirements.
Absolutely. So initially what we did was we started with building a web search for audio video. The reason we started limited to audio video was that we thought that there was a unique niche market that we can enter into, and that we can limit the amount of web that we have to index. To index the entire web, you need a lot of computing power and you need a lot of investment in infrastructure. Then in those days we did not have cloud, we can rent or something, right? We had to have our own data center. And so you have to crawl every page, that takes a lot of bandwidth. Then you have to index all of them. The size of index is larger than the original data source, right? That means, in fact, if you think about a search engine, a search engine has to be able to store more data than the entire web that is out there. Think about it, right? So many people have their own websites, and they have all the data. Search engine actually have to have more storage because they need the entire page, they cache the page. You remember earlier days, Google used to cache the page if things were down. Now you don't have cache default coming up, but there were cache pages, so they had a copy of that. And of course, you have to store all the index, all the statistics, all the co-occurrences, right? So there'll be huge things. So we decided to focus on audio and video. But we wanted to cover a good we wanted to be able to serve a broad variety of consumer need. So we had domains, news, business, sports, entertainment, and so on, and some more. And within, let's say, sports, we had professional sports and amateur sports, meaning college. And then within professional and both of them, we'll have football, soccer, cricket, baseball, and so on and so forth. And within that, we'll have domain-specific things. For example, in the case of baseball, there are teams and there is a game at either home stadium or remote stadium, same thing as in football. But if it is cricket, then there are 11 main players on each side and there are different positions. The same way football has a quarterback. Well, cricket has a wicketkeeper, right? So there are different, they are meaningful, right? They are very important. It is important for us to understand that the person that we are indexing is a quarterback or some other position, a person playing another position. That is what the semantics is about. So the schema of the ontology had all of this thing modeled, right? And then let's take an example of music. Once we have model the music where it says performer, label, so artist, the label, the records, the tracks. These are the things that are very specific to music, right? Then what we will do is to go to high quality knowledge sources. Today, the example of that is Music Brains.
If you go to musicbrainz.org, I believe, you have 700,000 artists, all their tracks, all their genre, everything was is there, right? So we would that would become we will write a specialized extractor that that has understanding of how to crawl that particular data source or knowledge website, or it could be licensed content that then just like in XML come to us and we organize in our knowledge base. So we would then for an artist, we'll have all the artists. One of the artists would be say Madonna, right? And then we'll have all the tracks and everything. So the entire knowledge will be known to us, right? And the interesting thing would be that these agents would run periodically. So we would know that in some case knowledge changes very fast. In other case, knowledge changes very slowly. So these were software agents. There was infrastructure to wake them up and make them run. And the thing that I asked you to do, for example, Sony, was like, when was the last time the extractor ran? How much data did it create? Right? And things of that nature, all that information available through a kind of, a single interface. And for example, we would say that in the football, let's say US football, the trading happens at certain times. And that's when a lot of changes are there. So we will have scheduled to run our extractor to update itself in that frequency. The number of times there is a change in the US Senate, in the politics part of it, that doesn't happen too often. There are very few midterm elections, and there are very few elections where some senator is died or whatever happened, and somebody has been nominated. Other than that, there are elections are only every 2 years or every 4 years. So there's no need for us to run this thing every day or every month or so. So the extractor that will go to senate.gov and pick up all the knowledge about senators would run only very less frequently, right? And so all that knowledge will come and would be populated all the time. Different frequency, different domain you will do more often, in other domain you will do less often. And so we had roughly, I told you the main top level was sports and all those things. And the low level, we had about 25 domain models. Meaning an example would be professional football, college football. And that was about low level of the domain ontological model. And then would be the data, knowledge itself, the factual knowledge that this person plays at this position. And that would be populating that schema, knowledge-based schema or ontology schema. Does it make sense? Did I answer?
So when knowledge agents identify certain concept to be added, do the kind of person, the domain expert, do they kind of verify and adding into the world model or just the knowledge agent?
So there are rules. What would happen is that this becomes interesting part of ontology design also, right? So depends on how sophisticated your ontology design is. I'll give you one very specific example. The example is that of the US Office of First Lady, Political Office of First Lady, or President for that matter, right? Office of the President is a is something that is model. You have modeled the US government, and there is an Office of President, right? Now, in those days, President Clinton, when he started it in 1999, it was U.S. President. U.S. President was Clinton, Bill Clinton, right? And Hillary Clinton was the first lady, and that is what was in our knowledge base. Now, what happened was, and then we had model a constraint that any point of time there can be only one first lady. That is a constraint, right? So our problem will go knowledge base, etc., and it picks a fact that Hillary Clinton is the first lady, then it will check in the ontology and it says, that is the same thing, I already know that. So it will avoid that, right? But then after the 2000 election, first lady became Mrs. Bush. So then what we did was to make the knowledge, the fact that Hillary Clinton is the first lady, historical, and you know, Laura Bush, I believe, right, is the first lady, came out as the was it Laura Bush or Barbara Bush? Barbara Bush. In 2001? Okay, yeah. So Laura Bush is the first lady, and that became the fact. Now, current knowledge is that the first lady is Laura Bush. And that is how the thing was.
The example you took, it's at the instance level, right? I was more concerned about how you update the ontology.
The schema level?
Yes.
The schema level was done by graphical modeling. We had our own proprietary version of Protege tool. What you see, use today, Protege as a, you know, ontology modeling, and there are, you know, there's other one from a you know, number of vendors have that, right? Well, we had our own, you know, tool to design that, and that was done manually.
Okay.
Just like ontologies are even today, at least the schema part are done mostly manually.
So you had two people working on developing the models, right?
No. No, the entire whole process of Kiki, we came with all those things were two people because it was highly automated.
So these are basically these software just correct the facts, right?
Yeah.
If we are talking about, if you talk about the schema, is it updated with the two people?
Oh, much less than that. You don't need two people to create you know, on an ongoing basis. They are primarily there to write new agents. We found new source of knowledge. So we are able to write software extractor. What is beautiful, and in fact, I now feel we did a marvelous set of engineering, is that this knowledge agent was programmed by non-programmers. We had a software agent creation toolkit, a widget-based toolkit. And I don't know, I don't think you have the, I have a snapshot of toolkits in one of my presentations. And it was, they were widgets, so we had a part of crawling, side crawling, and we had tools to help them specify how they would want the site to be crawled. And for each type of the page, we had a ways to say, here is how you look at different parts of the, you know, structure and convert that structure into, you know, a set of facts that we extract. So semantics in a way, right? You have to, basically what it is, it's a syntax and structure, syntax handled by regular expressions, right? And structure, as in, you know, by kind of going on different parts of the pages. And at this page, I will find the track name. After this tag, you know, tag, I will find a track name. And so that will be done by essentially menu operations. And only thing they, only computing they need to know was to write regular expressions. And with that, they were able to create these software agents and schedule them to run using graphical toolkit. So the main work that they had was to write new agents, modify the agents because the site may change the structure and browse, you know, what, you know, variety of things. When the site does redesign, we have to reprogram. If this throws error, that you know, something will say to us that, oh, there is this extractor is throwing exceptions. Now you look up, and so that is what they were employed in. And then deal with special situations. Like the first time, we did not know that we'll have to deal with the things like first, there will be new first lady. But when the new first lady thing came, oh, we said we have to, we forgot, we did not model that constraint. We need to do the constraint, and how are you going to handle constraint violation? That how, because in one case, you may want to remove that fact, which is old and incorrect. In other case, you want to keep it historically available. Because we are doing web search, clearly some pages would be indexed at the time when Hillary Clinton was first lady. And if you remove the fact from the knowledge base that Hillary Clinton is first lady, then what happens? Then that semantics won't be there. In our, that part of semantics will be lost from semantics. So we had to keep the knowledge that Hillary Clinton is first lady, but except that she's no longer current new first lady. And we also had to have knowledge of the new first lady. So we have to keep that knowledge, and these are the interesting part of it.
Yes.
And then when we try to assert the knowledge in here, if there are errors, then these guys have to look it up, and that's what they will do.
I think I'm particularly looking for, like, let's say you have a specified music source, let's say music rate, right? Now you have, today, right, you have a track which has certain properties, time, artist and let's say album kind of thing. So you can write a software agent to go and grab all these things, right? So tomorrow there's a new concept called, let's say each track will have music video. So now your software agent does not know that there's a music video kind of thing, and it will never crawl that, right?
Yes.
So you have to add that manually to the schema and reconfigure your knowledge extractor.
Yes.
To grab it, right?
Yes, absolutely.
On lines of the saying that if new entity becomes added to the ontology and all, will that tamper the keywords such that we are doing before? Since till now our knowledge has only Hillary Clinton as a first lady, and we are getting all the web results based on that. And the next day, Laura Bush became a first lady, and we don't have that fact. But since we are not doing the normal keyword search, we won't get desired results, right? But if we had that keyword search, we would have got good results.
Yeah, no, you're asking a very interesting question. In fact, why is it so hard to do semantic search for any search engine? These are just some examples of it. That suppose my search engine is smart enough to know that this person is a first lady or president. This is not that simple though. Right? We just found out how hard it is that if the content was created before the election day or inauguration day, then I need to use this knowledge. If it was created after, then I need to use this knowledge. And I have to keep that all information available. Right? And you know, if I use Clinton, Bill Clinton, what role will I achieve? So, because semantic search engine needs to understand the context, right? Or human will understand the context. Human will understand the context that Bill Clinton was the governor of Arkansas, that he was a Rhodes Scholar, that he was a president of the United States, and twice in the one. And when you look at a particular data item, you would know that context. You have that all. Your brain is applying all that history. You have no problem in figuring out, oh, this was the data from the time he was a governor. But if your search engine only thinks that Bill Clinton was a past president and has no knowledge of governor, it's going to look dumb to a reader now, right? And that is why making all these things semantic is so hard. It's not just to know, be able to know that Bill Clinton is president. You need to know Bill Clinton was president between year 2000 and from year 1992 and 2000, right? And then other part, now he heads the Clinton Foundation and does all these good things, right? And in this contextual thing, there's so much knowledge about just the entity Bill Clinton. There's such a vast number of things packed by time, packed by location, packed by person, other context, and that is what makes it very, very hard. So that is why if you think about it, let's say, you look at the article and interviews of Amit Singhal, guy who is looking after this Google's 482 search, semantic search. And they say, they are thinking all these things hard and dealing with one thing at a time. And it's taking chance. So first they started focusing on thing, not stream, meaning entity. Now you just go through the interview after interview of Amit Singhal, and now they talk about more and more relationships. And they're somewhat getting, I'm just guessing, this is my interpretation, I may be wrong, that they're getting a little bit more comfortable that they can handle some type of relationships. But I bet you they may not have looked at all the issues of relationship, right? For example, I don't expect them to understand causality, right? That kind of relationship is not something they're going to understand. Oh, they are bright enough people that they understand that this is hard. I doubt that they are going to understand in any near future all the time issues that we dealt with. Because they have to do it massive scale with so much knowledge. We had the, I must admit that we did not have good scale. So there are also scale-related problems that they have to deal with that. And the scale of the problem is, see, when you deal with something like entertainment or sports
or you know, business or politics, there is still a little bit clarity in modeling the domain and knowledge in that area. But you can find many other areas where it will be far more complicated. Suppose you go into biology. Suppose you go in clinical care, healthcare. Suppose you go, the domains are a lot more richer than modeling politics and you know, basic politics and modeling entertainment. They are simpler domains. Here's a very interesting rule of thumb that I learned. Our group I started developing ontologies, and you know, I have a paper in 1993 that talks about ontologies and use of multipoints. 1994, CI came, we had a paper in federated ontologies. So you're talking about ontologies since that time. And in academic area, you might have developed probably the largest amount of ontologies, although not people do now even better work than we do on ontology development. But the rule of thumb is that if you are modeling a human-created aspect of world, the things are simpler, well-structured, shallow. So sports, travel, entertainment, they're not that hard. Everything, all the, I can really define fairly comprehensive schema to cover that domain. But if you start modeling the nature, the God or whatever you call, the natural world, the human body, then things are much harder.
Because
so
you don't understand that correctly.
You don't understand that. Also, the richness is amazing. So take an example of Glyco ontology that we developed. And some of you might have seen a picture from Glyco I show all the time. And Glyco is complex carbohydrate. And glycos, so these are, you might have done organic chemistry. And, sugar molecules, very complex. And the number of places the thing can bind, and the condition under which it can bind, the presence of certain enzyme, this thing will bind here, right? Modeling that kind of stuff, first of all, the fact is not readily available. It's not like here is an album and track and it's published there, right? It is somebody who does scientific experimentation. Somebody does mass spectroscopy. From that, he analyzes and he gets the signals. And from that, he interprets the signals and probably or likely this thing happens in this case. Now, it is that kind of knowledge you're trying to model, which of course is far harder. Any other thing for them?
Okay, so back to the architecture. So like he described, so knowledge agents will gather the information from the structured and unstructured data and some knowledge sources to upload the ontology as well. And then the extracted metadata, based on the extracted metadata, the pages will be automatically classified into the domain hierarchies that is there in the ontology. And at the same time, it will spot the entities in the document and then further enhance the metadata that they have, and they will be updated in the metabase. And then the semantic query engine will use the metadata and the ontology to answer the query. So
no,
let's
not talk more than that, I think.
But do we need to go in details, or we can show the example and describe?
No, what you need to still understand is why. So if you understand, first of all, this is automatic classification algorithm. And we were at one point using 9 classifiers and using boosting method. The idea was to understand what is the domain of the knowledge of the page. You're looking at a page here, right? Or data that is coming in. And this is speaking about, let's say, web page. One of the things you want to know is to find the domain so that you can use appropriate contextually relevant component of the ontology. You have all the stuff here, right? But if I come across word cricket, which cricket, if I know the domain, then I know, I can interpret that word. Or if I come across the word Tom Smith and I knew in here there are 10 different Tom Smiths. Which Tom Smith is this? Right? So you want to be able to do classification to know what domains are relevant to the content that you have. And you will rank the number of domains that are relevant. And based on that, you will use the contextual relevant knowledge base to find the entities in that thing. Again, this is the same thing that even any semantic search engine today will have to do, because you will have, you know, everything on the web. You know, you know, then you will have large knowledge base. Right now, what they have 750,000 or some such number, right? So this will keep on growing, and this will keep on eventually billion nodes, and you have to decide what which of those are relevant to that. Once you do that, then it helps you pick the appropriate metadata. And this container engine, by the way, is similar technology to that, but there's some variations here, right? Because you're not, now you're not dealing with, this one is high quality data converting into knowledge. This one is just data to, that is going to come out as a search result. Right? So this is, so they think about this being using ontology to annotate the text, and that annotations of metadata are being indexed for use of PolyMG. And the results would be basically a close to RDF kind of database.
So the query, that thing is structured query?
Yeah, this query is a faceted query. It is like in those days, the equivalent of Sparkle kind of thing, because we have RDF kind of database.
So, do you do DAML or some kind of representation that you define by yourself?
We did not formally use RDF, and we did not use DAML per se,
okay.
But the ontology, the entities and the relationship in the constraints.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah. It was not standard, it was not yet out there.
And how do you select ontology basically based on the domain you found? Because now, for example, one of the issues in Kino we have, when you search for a specific domain, you have a list of ontologies. You had that problem also at that
time?
Well,
no, I mean, we are under control, right? We don't have multiple ontology for the same domain in our case. We have one
just
ontology,
selected.
We choose, it's a populated ontology, it's very important. The facts are there, so it's a populated ontology.
Before going to the examples, I wanted to point out some things that happening in the metadata extraction. So, for example, consider these two pieces of text. And the first one, it talks about something in the financial domain, and this one means something related to the sport. But as you can see, John Smith is there in the both the text. So, it would identify John Smith as entity, but it is important to figure out that in which context that they are talking about the this person. So in order to do that, they consider the other relevant entities in the same paragraph, and then figure out the first one is for the finance domain and the second one is for the baseball domain. For example, when in the first piece of text, then they know about the company, then they have kind of idea this person is talking about in the finance. And in here, when they know about the Babe Ruth, then they know this is something relevant to the baseball domain. So they consider the context of the particular entity to identify into which domain that this would be relevant.
Yeah, usually it takes a lot more than that. For example, you have to understand venture capitalist,
yes.
Name of the company that Apple, and some other stuff, technology sector, investment. All these things are going to help you understand that is the context, that is the domain. It's not just spotting of them. There are two multiple ways. One is the spotting of each of the terms there and the types they are on and which ontology they are in. Other is machine learning.
Confidence level, and then the football and golf and these kind of things, and then it would identify the other entities appearing in the document and then present them as the metadata. So these are some other players.
But point is that those are done using the baseball ontology.
Yes.
Because
yes.
You know I have baseball,
yes.
So now.
So they have the sportsman, maybe another concept in the ontology, and then they give the details that they can give about the other entities that they
So this is an example of that automatic categorization. And this is about the enhanced metadata set. So do you want to add something?
So here, for example, you say here Kostanica, right? Or Wojtek Kostanica. Think about trying to understand this text as a natural language text, and here the word President Wojtek Kostanica is mentioned, right? That is one option that you try to understand from NLP that this is a precedent because it appears. But because our knowledge base already knows that Kostanica is a president of Yugoslavia, we don't rely on this to say that we found this entity and we know this entity and he is a president of this thing. Right? So that's one issue. Second thing will be that here we will find the name of, so suppose we found here the word Belgrade in here. Then because our knowledge base already knows that Belgrade is the capital of Yugoslavia, of course that is no more, and in Europe, we would automatically, this is called semantic enrichment, would automatically, you disambiguate it. So in the case of John Smith in the previous slide, you disambiguate, that is also part of automatic enrichment. This is also where you're giving, look at here, the word they only use for, let's say, Milosevic, and that given the context, it would be expanded to say Slobodan Milosevic, right? So this is semantic enrichment, and there are advantages for that. Now you know that this is, suppose say, give me the latest news on Europe. This will be latest news on Europe. But if you only knew index Belgrade and you don't have the knowledge that this is Europe, then you would not know that, right? Similarly, you say, give me all the news, suppose the word is aspirin. And you search by aspirin, you'll get aspirin's answer. But you search for give you all the latest news on painkillers. And your knowledge, you don't have knowledge base that says aspirin is a painkiller, then you're not going to find the articles about aspirin then, right? So that these are some example use of knowledge base to enhance query processing. Yeah, so what happens is that for the, our knowledge base, our ontology rather, has for a news event, these are all the properties that we are trying to see. And the objective would be for the content extractor to maximally, to complete as much as possible automatically, without any human involvement. We always had this option for humans to add more information if they wanted to. Remember, this is still 1999, 2000, so Yahoo was still pretty fresh, it had not gone away. Yahoo directory was still there. And so there was still, some role of humans in the process, which is coming back, by the way, to some extent. So some of these things, so it picks up, headline description, URLs, media types, location, people. So essentially the idea was that we imagine that for a news content, these are the facets of properties that are most important. And matches against that would be improving the search rather than just the keywords for everything else, right? So most of this will be automatically, what you see here was automatically completed, and humans can extend it, validate it, spot check it, whatever you want to do, you can do that.
So these facets, are they depend on the domains you have? Or?
Right. So for this was a news content. In our ontology, these are all the schema has all the facets or property types we have, and so the objective is to write a content extractor that will maximally extract from this automatically as much as possible. In the process, is constantly consulting ontology and also doing disambiguation and doing the enhancement and number of those things that is happening. There are also a lot of other things that are not very important, but getting this URL was not that hard, so not that easy. Sometimes you had embedded URLs. In one case, we had to go 7 level deep to actually get the real video URL, because it would be part of some objects rather than the raw media. And we wanted to get to the actual media so that when consumer finds the search result, they can actually play the whole thing, just select the media file, nothing else. because that was the aspect of user experience.
Okay, so this is about the enhancing the metadata, and then this is the video search that they had since they started Tali with the video search. So this is the browsing interface, and as you can see, here we can find some domains that we can use for the search, and this is the facets that we can enter when we are searching. We have title here, and for example, we can enter the classification, so the search engine know that this alien that it searched for is it in the movie asset under the movie.
So there are two philosophical points. Here you are seeing one point where this is an attribute-based or facet-based or property-based search. The other would be like Google kind of search box where you just enter something and get the keyword. So we had both of them. This one, what happens is that somebody says, I'm interested in movie. So when you click on that, it automatically gives you these properties you can search by. You can complete any part of it. You don't have to complete all of that. If you do all of them, it is more like a database search, right? So you can complete whatever you want, and then alien, but at least I know the context of alien is title here. Of a movie, right? So the results will be very high quality compared to going to any search engine and doing search on alien. They won't have context, right? I'll show you what happens if you just type in alien. We also had a keyword search like any other search engine. I'll show in the slide later on. It's called semantic directory. That will give you the options.
So then, once searching with that keyword, then it will give like different views that they had about this particular.
And you can buy the, so this will directly link you to Amazon or thing here. So this is data coming from a third party source about movie description, right? So this is also content enrichment, right? That did not come from the web page that was crawled. This is similarly in a free base or in a Google knowledge base using Wikipedia. Same general idea. Here is a description. Here is the media clip. Typically, in the movie, it will be publication or publicity clip thing. Okay, not the whole full movie. And here, this is you click on this, and it will take you to Amazon and give you exactly the thing to buy. And it will take you exactly to that particular movie, not anything else.
So I think with respect to the movie search, I think even the Yahoo has something like this now because they have the integrated data about the movies.
And so Yahoo is well suited to do this kind of thing because Yahoo has kind of a separate, quote unquote, they call properties, right? They have Yahoo Auto, they have Yahoo Sports, they have this thing. And in fact, they have different infrastructure, all of them. Some of them are heavily using RDF or completely. So Yahoo Finance was one of the only website that comprehensively use RDF in the level, yeah. But because they are domain specific, they could do similar things that we are trying to do.
So this is for the search about this person called Jamal Anderson, and searching this one would go into this page, which will give you an exact match and a close match. So do you want to say anything about how it is based on, probably it is not based on only the keyword?
So no, it is not. So it was stratified search. So the idea would be to find this term in the very context of that particular property type. If that is not found, then it will find in that domain. If not found, it will use it as a keyword. So the lowest common denominator is keyword that any other search engine would do. Except we did not have page. But other than that, whatever the search engine had, we could do it also. If there are multiple Andersons, the system would know them. Jamal Anderson, now what would happen here is, very interestingly, you can search, let's say, for Atlanta Falcon. So suppose you look at this. This was the original page, by the way. And you look at the page, and see, it says, week 3, top 10, Anderson TD run. And then it says Jamal Anderson runs 26 yards touchdown against Panthers. Nowhere in this is the fact that Jamal Anderson belongs to Falcons, Atlanta Falcons. However, our metadata has Atlanta Falcons. How did you get that? This is the huge power of semantic search, which even today nobody does. Right? So if you search for Falcon, we will find you this, even though there is no mention of Falcon here whatsoever. This is something that, again, in principle, any of the things, including Google semantic search, will try to do. Right? And this here is a rich media interface, and we have different forms of it. So when you do Google search and you get on this right hand side, this thing, this was what we were doing, and there are different forms of it. In other cases, we have lot more showing that. So we used to call rich media object. I don't know whatever, you know, today's search engine call that. But that rich media object base was coming from the knowledge base.
So Google has that snippet, right? For the entities
in there. Right. So this is what they call snippet, we used to call rich media, you know, not, because ultimately it's that information coming from the knowledge base.
Yeah.
So we have the, because we also had knowledge base, we have that. This is, in this case, this is meta, sorry, there will be another slide that will show that better. But this is all the metadata we have, see, right? For each this entity, we have all this metadata. In some cases, like this, we figured out Jamal Anderson, we looked at the knowledge base, and we found out, and we know, of course, it is, you know, NFL, right? And because we have knowledge base for NFL, we know Jamal Anderson plays for Atlanta Falcons, so we automatically complete that ourselves. This is content enrichment, semantic enrichment. So you search here, you get all this result, you click on that, you this is the rich media object. See, precise media search, and I don't know where is rich media, okay. So this is the object we are creating. In this, some data is coming from knowledge base. We integrated it, not separately. Today, you know, I think Google shows the search results separately from the snippet, right? We had another version where we also showed snippet, kind of, again, we used for each media object. But we integrated that here. And here, you click on it, you can see the video, and you see all this metadata, and then you can see the source where we got the data from. Yeah, it says it. Note that the team name and league name are also included in the metadata, which are not in the content.
Would you like to go through the other example as much as you anyway have?
So this is the same thing as any search engine. I'm just typing in the keyword. Right? Now, the moment I type in the keyword, I see what is in my knowledge base. Where is Commerce One? And I know that Commerce One gives me the context of business. So I showed them the business thing here. So this is a part of the ontology schema that comes because I know that Commerce One is a company. These are all the different, you know, you can see here, sports, politics, science and technology, travel. See, these are all the things. You talk about Yahoo directory, they had this, our ontology, this is the top level of our ontology as a whole, right? Now, when I do Commerce One, I know that is business, and you see what is happening here. And by the way, I mark you that you will see this kind of stuff in semantic search in next 2-3 years. The following company executives associated with Commerce One Inc. The following companies are compete with the Commerce One Inc. Right? The company Commerce One members of the following industry. The Commerce One identified by the following sticker symbol. The Commerce One competes with the following companies. So these are all the things coming from knowledge base. And these are all the, and then there is some other part which I have not shown, which is all the data, you know, pages, or which is, it talks about Commerce One, which is search results. So there's search results and the knowledge base or ontology semantic part of the result. So here I am typing what did we type in? The same thing. Crucial news. So here crucial news on Commerce World, and they are coming up, and here I am showing you the relationships I'm interested in, competition. So I am not only able to show you all the things about Commerce World, But be with one click, I'm giving you all the news about the competitor of Commerce. So if you think, see, search engines are used for consumers. But if you think about a business user, professional user, then they have clear needs for that. So if somebody has, imagine for the moment that somebody is in the financial industry, then what do they want? They want to keep track with what is happening in the, if suppose somebody is a stockbroker and he specializes in this particular market, then he wants to keep up with all the major players and, hey, what is this computer doing? If this stock is going down, should I buy his computer stock? If the company has patented new technology, who else will be affected? Whose stock will go down? So they need to do all those things here. So on the move, B2B market says they're downgrading the competitor of Commerce One. Then the stock market broker will immediately say, that means, is it a downgrade because of a systemic industry space related result? Then, oh, Commerce One will be also downgraded. Let me sell the stock. Or is it a reason that Ariba has a factory where there is a flood and the factory is going to be down for 6 months, but Commerce One does not have the factory? Many of you should know this example, very well known example from business case. There used to be the Ericsson was a major a company along with other what are the other major vendors of telephone switches and so on and so forth, right? Of wireless technologies, the towers that are built up and all that. And what happened was that there was some fire or some flood or whatever. This is for cell phone. In Motorola and Ericsson, these are all competing. Now the market has changed. Motorola is bought by Google also. And what happened was that there was a fire at a silicon manufacturing factory where Ericsson was getting majority of its chips, and that got wiped off. And the competitor went and made sure got all the, in fact multiple people companies were getting it. But one of them immediately reacted and got all the rest of the supplies booked up. And Ericsson, lost the supply. In fact, that is the reason why Ericsson had to sell out and it became Sony Ericsson, as an example. Right? So it's a very, very well-known example of supply chain. But business, any people are constantly thinking about that, right? When things happen, it's going to affect this, it's going to happen. Is Apple downgrade because of technology downgrade as a whole, or Apple downgrade because it is not selling well in China? But Samsung is selling inside Samsung, so don't sell Samsung. These are the things that you have to do. So this is what semantics allow you to do that. So anyway, you are getting see competition result here. Of course, you can see the results of Commerce One also, right? Here you are typing David Dua. So there is Eric Dua and David Dua. David Dua is a golf guy. Eric Dua is in some other area. So system knows, and so it automatically gives you this, and then it gives you all the things about David Dua. But in addition, it shows you attributes of golf, location, tournament, course, player. You click on player, and it gives you all the top five players. You can click on anything, so basically you can semantically go from any of the things. Of course, you have all the countries like in search results, and here you say some of the related sites that are done. So part of, because that, these are the main sites where you can get a lot of good golf data and stories. But you can understand the search here. This is, you can, that you type in a word, but because it is a thing, it is an entity. And not only it is an entity, because we know the relationships. These are relationships, right? A player is a relationship. Tournament is a relationship. Course name is a relationship at that level. So we know that. What would happen today, for search engines will be, they will increasingly, they're trying to figure out how should we present relationship? Will it work for not wrong? These are the questions that Google and Bing and others have to answer. Because if you give too much results to consumer, then they will get confused also. That doesn't mean that will also work. So it is not just the fact that you have to have knowledge, but then
user interface and all those things also will slow you down.
Dr. Shiv, how are the players ranked in that slide?
These are the, there is one side that ranks the players and it is picking up that knowledge from them. Top 100 tennis players, there's a rank published, right? But people were voting that based on how they perform in tournament. So there is that. So because we extract them from that side, and in our knowledge base, we maintain the rank of the player and continue to keep up to date. So we can do this kind of stuff. So this is, you know, timely thing. This is knowledge base. This is that will change. Tomorrow you go and it may be different rank. So this is why semantics is hard. It's not like I can just get it once and keep it up with it. I have to keep on, you know, that's why our knowledge extractor run continuously as needed and pick up new knowledge. So this knowledge base have to be kept up. Here is Robert Duvall. And Robert Duvall is a movie guy. He's an actor. So you can see now you get different. So you can see here, entertainment movies. And you can see properties of movies. And for the cast, here are well-known cast. And looking for Robert Duvall as in, you know, as cast in the movie. The relationship is known as cast in the movie. Maybe we should end today here.
And I have a homework because I want to finish at least on next Tuesday.
Right.
So if you remember the features that we discussed with respect to semantic search, I would like to have a discussion by saying, okay, how or what are the techniques that we need to do that to implement that particular semantic feature. So if you can have a look at it, then our discussion will be more interesting and I will be able to finish this at least by next Tuesday. Thank you.
Thank you. So guys, we really need to have the projects lined up now. So two things. For the next